Who should decide when the United States goes to war? The Constitution gives Congress the power to declare war. Presidents insist that as commander-in-chief, they have a right to decide to use force. But what about the American public? Should the Constitution be amended to require that a national referendum be held before the country goes to war? Now that might sound like a radical idea, but 74 years ago, the majority of Americans thought that they, not the president and not Congress, should have the final say on when the country went to war. Hi, I'm Jim Lindsay, and this is Lessons Learned. Our topic today is the Ludlow Amendment, which was voted on the floor of the House of Representatives on January 10, 1938. So what was the Ludlow Amendment? The Ludlow Amendment was a requirement to amend the United States Constitution to stipulate that no congressional declaration of war would be binding until after a nationwide referendum was held. The only exception, according to the Ludlow Amendment, would be in the case of the United States being attacked or invaded. So why was the Ludlow Amendment even an issue? Why were Americans talking about changing the language of the Constitution when it came to issues of war and peace? There really were sort of three developments in operation. The first was the lingering consequences of World War I. The United States had gone to war in April of 1917 with great enthusiasm, believing that it would, in the immortal words of President Woodrow Wilson, make the world safe for democracy. But by the time we got to the 1930s, those cheers had turned to jeers, as many Americans were convinced that the war had not been fought for the right reasons and had not produced the promised outcomes. Many Americans in the 1930s subscribed to the so-called Merchants of Death thesis, which argued that President Wilson had maneuvered the country into war as part of a broader plan to help manufacturers and capitalists make a profit over preparing the country for the war. That Merchants of Death thesis was fueled by a second major development, which was the Great Depression. United States saw unemployment reach levels of 1 out of 4, 25% of the workplace unemployed. That managed to turn many Americans looking inward, worrying about what was happening at home and fearful of being entangled in issues abroad. And the third development that occurred in the 1930s was the gathering storm clouds in both Europe and in Asia. In 1935, Italy invaded Ethiopia. 1936 sees the Spanish Civil War and Adolf Hitler violating the terms of the Treaty of Versailles and remilitarizing the Rhineland. 1937 sees the Japanese begin the so-called Second Japanese-Chinese War. Many Americans looked out at this rather forbidding landscape and were worried that their leaders, particularly President Franklin Roosevelt, were too eager to go to war. Their answer was the Ludlow Amendment, which was named after Representative Lewis Ludlow, its chief sponsor. Now, the Ludlow Amendment had some powerful opponents, chief among them FDR. He worked for several months with his allies on Capitol Hill to keep the amendment from coming to a vote on the floor of the House. The New York Herald Tribune dismissed the Ludlow Amendment as a lunatic proposal. Even some isolationists who opposed FDR's policies and worried that he was too enthusiastic about a possible war opposed the Ludlow Amendment. Senator Arthur Vandenberg of Michigan argued that the Ludlow Amendment would be as sensible as requiring a town hall meeting before allowing the fire department to put out the blaze. But eventually, proponents of the amendment got their way, and a vote was held on January 10, 1938. After some heated discussion and debate, the House voted to reject the amendment. The vote was 209 to 188. Now, 188 sounds like a large number, but keep in mind this was an effort to amend the Constitution. That required a two-thirds positive vote, or 290 votes. So the Ludlow Amendment failed on January 10, 1938, and now is sort of in the trivia section of many history books. What lessons should we draw from the congressional debate over this so-called lunatic proposal? I think the most important thing about the Ludlow Amendment is that it reminds us that the attitudes Americans have toward issues of war and peace and who should get to decide those matters has varied over time. And those attitudes have varied depending upon how Americans have felt in terms of their overall security and in terms of how well things are going here at home. In the 1930s, Americans were worried that their presidents and members of Congress might be too inclined to go to war. But compare that after World War II, where many Americans were worried that presidents perhaps didn't have enough power to go to war. Or come full forward today, wherever, let's say, the decision to support Operation Odyssey Dawn in Libya led once again to a series of debates over what presidents can or cannot do and whether presidents should or should not listen to public opinion. Whatever your opinion on the Ludlow Amendment or the broader question of who should get to decide when the United States goes to war, it remains the case that it's important to know history because what happened in the past can inform our debates today. Or as the great writer Mark Twain put it, history may not repeat itself, but it rhymes.